I'm Jackie Edwards. On behalf of the Arbor Resource Committee, the Department of Public Works, and the town of Bedford, tonight, as we bask in the coming of spring, hallelujah, finally, and chair of the Bay Circuit Alliance, a collaboration of the trustees of reservations and the Appalachian Mountain Club, and I, no, Appalachian, thank you, Mountain Club. And the, formerly the executive director of the Sudbury Valley Trustees, tonight's speaker, Ron McAdow, is currently publisher and editor-in-chief of the Personal History Press. Ron will describe the natural and man-made forces that alter our forest habitat and determine which wildlife species can prosper and which can no longer, as we see original slides of regional wildlife, including beaver, wolf, bears, owls, and hawks, taken when Ron's motion-triggered camera was set off as the animals themselves passed by, proof that today, even wildlife takes selfies. On that note, please join me in welcoming Ron.
Offer you some information and some stories, and both the information that I have in my head and the stories also stem from the joy that I take in nature and in the connection with nature and in understanding at least superficially some of the transactions in the natural world. So the elephant was in Africa. This is my backyard. These are bluebirds trying to get the last fledgling to come out. The others are all up in a tree and this guy won't leave the box. And so the mother is standing anxiously by, and the father has food. And he says, really, bluebirds are a cavity nesting species, and so those species that are have to nest in a cavity used to be always a hollow tree. Now we make some of the hollow trees. Well, that hunger I have for connection with nature and for understanding something about it led me some years back to sign up for a walk with the man on our left is John McCarter. He's an expert tracker. Have any of you ever met John? He leads outings from time to time, and I signed up for one out at Oxbow National Wildlife Refuge. Here he is, looking down into his hand, which is full of beaver poop, which excited him a great deal because he wanted, and he had me take a picture of it because he wanted a slide. He needed a slide of it. Usually they go in deeper water, so this was an unusual opportunity. So on this walk, we looked at scats, mostly an animal sign, but a lot of the animal sign is the droppings. He showed us a place where otters, river otters, used to cross from the river to a pond, and I thought, gee, I'd really like to see the otters. Now, I talked that up, and a man who knows about wildlife said, you can buy cameras that are motion triggered. And so I got a little grant, and I bought some cameras. The purpose of the grant was sort of to show the what came along at night on wildlife trails, and it was, the idea was to show us public people that animals really are in these refuges, because you know when we go for a walk in our conservation land, we don't see many animals because they're out at night and they're shy and they stay away from us. So anyway, I bought this equipment and I ran into trouble right away. First, the river flooded. That wasn't good for the electronics, and then the animals ate the cables, and so there was a learning curve. But eventually, I got my very first picture, which was of a picture of an animal. I had many pictures of a pine branch going in the breeze during my learning curve. But the first picture of an animal was this beaver. And it was very exciting to me. And it's an appropriate animal to start our talk with tonight because obviously it's one that has a lot to do with trees and forests, and we'll We'll talk about them in various ways. Now, the landscape that the beaver effect, the beaver lived on, was created by the last ice age, as you know, and the ice came down and dropped its burden of sand and gravel to make Cape Cod and the islands. And then it was followed by ice age mammals that later became extinct, the megafauna. One of those animals was a giant beaver. And this giant beaver, which was lived here in the ice age, apparently, it was as long as I am tall, and it weighed, the little ones weighed the same as me, and the big ones weighed 100 pounds more. So it was a massive beaver that came after the ice age. One of the effects of the glacier is that it left glacial lakes around, and so a lot of the landscape that we see, there's a chair right here, sir, is the glacial lake beds where we have the best farming. And this is at 9 Acre Corner near Verrill Farm. There's a it's flat, and that's because as the sediments settled in to the glacial lake, they were flat. Then there are these ridges. How many of you are very fond of eskers? Okay, so and how many of you have never heard of an esker?
What was
it?
Esker. 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 It's some of our favorite land form, and the way that it in the glacier, it's a glacial feature. The glaciers left. I've seen this in a you know how after the winter the snow where it's been piled up and piled up and piled up for months, and then it's there as a remnant well into the warm weather. And you can see the same thing in miniature. The water drained down through this, you know, many, many feet of ice overhead and found and melted drainage channels. Well, the ice wasn't pure. The ice had a burden of sand and gravel. And so as it came down and it went through these melted, sinuous meltwater channels, it dropped debris. And that's what made eskers like this one. It's hard to photograph. We need 3D. But it's a very steep-sided ridge on both sides, and people love to run trails along the top of them. And it looks for all the world like somebody spent a whole lot of money to create a beautiful vista and view, but it was from the glacier. So anyway, the ice age is what left us the landscape that we're talking about this 400 years of history on. And these are, by the way, all those megafauna died out very similar to the time that people first came here. So it's hard to avoid the conclusion that there was some kind of cause and effect, but there's no evidence, apparently, that the people hunted the giant beavers. But if anybody did hunt them, these paleo Native Americans or paleo Indians would be the ones who did, going back 9,000 years, almost, you know, to the time when it wasn't a forest, there was tundra. And they were, here's a fluted point that was in Concord. Now, this is a good time, since this illustration is giving credit for itself. I have an inherent conflict, like anyone in this internet age, of wanting to respect intellectual property, but also wanting to use good resources for you to see them. So the answer, as usual, is credit. And I have here a source sheet. And I brought some of the books that I've used, and I'll hold them up as we go along. And that's the best I'm going to do about most of the photographs are mine. I've borrowed a very few. So we jumped over the native populations in the intervening time between the paleo Indians and the people who were here when the Europeans arrived, which, you know, in the late 1500s they started coming and trading, and in 1600 and they brought their germs. And as you're probably aware, you know, the germs, this was well before the Pilgrims and the Puritans, the people coming to trade and dry fish infected the native populations, and they were devastated by these diseases from Europe that they had no resistance to. So when the Pilgrims and Puritans came in 1620 and 1630, when Boston was settled, they found open fields that the Indians had cleared, and thought that this was going to work out very nicely for them. However, there still were Native Americans here living in these locations. Now, this book is, I mean, this map is from a book that is, maybe some of you have seen this, Historical Atlas of Massachusetts, so it's one of the important sources for tonight. Another important source is the Harvard dioramas. Have you visited the Harvard dioramas and seen? So those of you with a big interest in forest history will have seen, and there's a book about them that is has pictures of the dioramas, and here's a picture of one of, this is the diorama that shows the pre-settlement forest. The pre-settlement forest in New England, in Massachusetts, and obviously there were local differences everywhere, but it wasn't a steady state of nothing ever changing, because beavers, for one thing, would change. They were an agent of change in a forest, but also storms and natural diseases that came through, and the natives burned, did some forest management to make their hunting easier. So this pre-settlement forest was, from our perspective, a virgin forest, but it wasn't just something that never ever changed. Well, the people came, and they were farmers, but it took a lot of work to turn the forest into farmland. Meanwhile, there's the beaver again. And this is another one of the pictures from the Camera in the Woods project, the motion figure cameras, where this fellow obliged us by wearing a weed on his forehead. I guess it's a coincidence, about the same time that New England started to be settled, the European beavers were almost extirpated. Apparently they were very similar to our beavers. Europeans had long since realized that the under fur of the beaver makes a fabulous felt, a felt that is waterproof and that can be turned into the best of hats. Until I came upon this picture, I didn't realize that I always associated beavers with top hats, but no, all these felt hats were made out of beaver. The best ones were 100% beaver, and then they blended them down so that you could get a half beaver, I guess, for a cheaper price. Well, so enormous pressure was put on the local beaver population. I think the Indians were catching the beaver and selling them to traders, and the beaver's population by 1700 gone. So they were a source of cash to anyone who could get their hands on them. Another source that before agriculture, of course, was venison, and so the deer were here, but the deer also declined. They were never eliminated, but they were vastly reduced over time. Again, this map from the Massachusetts Historical Atlas showing the spread of settlement, familiar to you. And this one is, this doesn't show Bedford for obvious reasons, but this one does show Bedford. If we zoom in, there we are, because it was 1729, is that when it was set off, I think. And it was settled long before that as part of Billerica and Concord. So by 1729, there were mature farms in town that looked, would have looked like this. Now, I have read in different places that originally people used wood for their fences, and that the stone came somewhat later, and it's the stone. And I've also heard that the low stone walls were topped with wood. But as wood became more precious, the stone became more and more of the building material. Stone walls. If you like to ramble around in the woods and you try to, think back in time to earlier days. Here's a book called Exploring Stone Walls. So, you know, there are different types. Here's one that has, it's basically two large stones then filled in with small stones in the middle. And then the kind of familiar single stone. So people were practicing agriculture. They were growing livestock. And they were faced with timber wolves, gray wolves. The eastern gray wolf. I did not take this picture. That's one I didn't take. And the sheep and wolves, the sheep didn't do well, and the farmers didn't like the wolves. And so there was very early on a bounty on wolves, and the wolves were far more common, I think, than the panthers. This cougar, you know, mountain lion, cougar, panther, those are all the same animal. And so we'll call it eastern cougar. This is the last one killed in Vermont, and it was in 1881. The wolves, if you look back in the founding towns' histories of like Concord or Billerica, the early towns, they very early on started paying bounties for wolves, and so the wolves took it on the chin, and so did the bears. The bears, I did take that picture. I'm very happy about it. The bears went way down, and you know, since then they've been coming back. As I was thinking about, after I'd been asked to give this talk, I was at the Museum of Fine Arts and I saw this painting, and I, you know, it's so cool that you're allowed to take pictures at the museums now, I think. So I took out my cell phone and I took a picture of this painting. It's by a painter named Cropsey. I've never heard of him, but that doesn't mean much because I don't know that much about art. But it's called the Shattuck Mountain and the Housatonic Valley in Connecticut, and the date is 1845. And here's a close-up of the middle of this painting. So here in the middle. So this is time travel. There's no forest. The forest is gone. Except on the mountainside, you can see in the foreground, and instead is a scattering of trees and a very heavy pressure on the land for agriculture. So this was a good time for creatures like bobolinks, which a lot of the fields were for pasture for livestock. You know, depending on the quality of the soil and everything. And so bobolinks, which are very scarce here now as the forest is regrown, were a popular species. Bluebirds did well in those days. A bluebird's basically a bird of open areas, although they're pretty adaptable, and we know they'll nest close to trees now. And now we get into the time of Henry Thoreau. And he's another way of, you know, reading his journals is time travel for sure. He came into life at about the same time that the Erie Canal was completed. And then when he went out to Walden, that was in the 1840s, the railroads had been coming in for 10 years and they had completed the Fitchburg line. So he watched the train run by the pond. This isn't his photograph, but it was the same, you know, the Fitchburg line that runs the same way by Walden Pond. And he walked up and down the tracks when he went into town. And so between the railroads and the Erie Canal, here's the Erie Canal, which was connecting the Midwest through the Great Lakes to the Midwest, to the Hudson River, and the very first railroad that ran west from Boston was the Boston-Worcester, but then it was soon extended to Albany, Reed, Erie Canal. So all of a sudden, agricultural products from a much easier place to do farming were coming here, and that changed. That's part of our history tonight because that introduced farm abandonment. Now, it's not as if farms were abandoned all at once, but during Henry's life, he died during the Civil War, that time leading up to the Civil War and after it, the farming population was reduced. Our industries grew. We prospered economically, I guess, but not through farming, and the farms started growing back up with to white pine. So this brings us up to the time, well, so here's, you know, the farmers had laboriously removed all these rocks. You know how they say New England grows rocks because the frost pushes them up and then, and they float to the top, so they're, the farmers would can be confronted with rocks that had come up from the frost heap from below. And so they, this is a pile of rocks that that's people had spent an awful lot of backbreaking labor to move. And there in the background, the field that was probably a garden or tillage has grown up with trees. Here's another, a similar picture of the foreground, again a pile of rocks, but this one, this was the second picture I used at the beginning of the presentation, because in the upper right, that's a red cedar, which of course is very slow to decay, but that cedar grew up and died a long time when this was, before there was a mature forest around it, the cedar was one of the, was part of the woody plants that could pioneer in the old field. And the, you know, they used that word, and I hear that Thoreau coined it, succession, forest succession, but it's, I don't know if that's true or not, but anyway, as part of the forest succession, red cedar, and then here is a white pine towering over and shading out the red cedar, and that all over New England, apparently the pattern was white pines replaced, they took over and replaced the where there had been a field, there were big stands of white pine. This picture, the soil moved during the agricultural days. So look what happened here. It washed downhill and then caught on the stone wall. And apparently, this is a very common phenomenon. If you're into reading the landscape as you tramp around, this is one of the things you'll see is. Way before it was a forest, because now the trees are holding the soil in place, but in when agricultural practices weren't so sophisticated, there was soil erosion. The pine stands produced, over a period of time, a very valuable crop of white pine. And that was, they were harvested, dates vary depending on where you were in New England, but sometime in the late 19th century, early 20th century, the farmers would sell the white pine. Before there was corrugated cardboard, it was used for boxes and pails and matchsticks and all kinds of woodenware. And they took a portable sawmill out to a pond and clear cut the pine, which then was followed by mixed hardwoods. So here come the deer. And notice that the mixed hardwoods are not really what you're looking at here. You're looking at shrubs, and that shrubland habitat is the name that is given to a middle sort of successive, early successive stage. And certain animals, like indigo buntings, really need that. That shrubby habitat. Another animal that loves this early succession is the ruffed grouse, one of my favorite birds. Now, this picture, when I first came to New England as a young man, I would often see ruffed grouse, and now I've almost never do. You probably have the same experience. I even had one of the huge experiences of my life was tramping on snowshoes and having a ruffed grouse burst out of the snow in front of me, which they roost under the snow. And at the time, it was so unexpected. But then I read, oh yeah, this is what they do. So this, however, this was a camera in the woods picture taken some years back, and I just love the picture because the dappled sunlight on the bird, and it shows the, you just can't see the edge of that bird, and it shows how effective the protective coloration is, and he's almost all in focus on this bird. That didn't happen very often. For Christmas counts, hoping to get one of the ruffed grouse, to find a ruffed grouse and add it to the count, I've gone back to this place many years, and I've never seen one since these pictures were taken. Well, into the deer, of course, were coming back and doing well and being harvested. Of course, this is camera in the woods. And here the hardwoods are growing up, the mixed hardwoods. Now, what was a tree that was dominant in this forest that is not any longer?
Chestnut.
I'm thinking of chestnut, but elm's not a wrong answer. And you know, but the American chestnut was really dominant. And I found out that in colonial days, they liked to make, if they couldn't have enough chestnut for their whole log cabin, because it didn't rot very much, it was very rot resistant, they would use the chestnut they had for the bottom of the log cabin. And it was fast growing and hardy, and so it produced nut crops and was just a tree that everybody appreciated. This is the range of the American chestnut originally, and it was attacked by a blight that started in the in the early 20th century, and we still see the stump sprouts. This, it grows up in a sprout, and then the blight takes it away, and we don't have it any longer. This is the, oh, here it is. The chestnuts were, it was believed, from introduced on nursery stock, and in 1904 at the Bronx Zoo. And it was spread by a chestnut bark beetle up to 50 miles per year. So by 1950, nearly all canopy chestnut trees were dead. I live in Lincoln, and this was the Lincoln chestnut that is on the town seal, and there's a stone there where the chestnut stood. So it's a beloved tree, and a lot of people are working to bring it back. They're using three different strategies to bring it back, and they hope that they use many volunteers. Maybe some of you are volunteers for the American Chestnut Society. They are making progress, and they hope one day that the forest will have a tree that it won't be genetically identical to the American chestnut, but it will be vastly preponderant of its genes will be the American chestnut. They're working specifically to make sure that that's true. There's a Chinese chestnut that's kind of in the picture, and it's very complicated. But so now that this has gotten us into the 20th century, and the next huge catastrophe that came along for New England forests was the hurricane of 1938 with 186 mile an hour winds, and it blew down huge swaths of our forest. And now that would have happened, you know, at any time back through prehistory too. One of the things I've learned in learning to read the landscape is that when you get a blowdown like this, this pattern of there's a hole and then a mound is visible for many years. Now here again, it's much harder to see the depth, but there's a depression there and a mound there, and this is long, long after the tree is rotted away, but it's called a pillow and cradle formation. And so one of the things you can find in the woods, when you can see a whole area where there's a pillow and cradle, and that means there was a huge blow down there, maybe from the hurricane of 1938. This shows all those blown down trees became a forest fire hazard. There was a lot of harvesting of them. And
By Lane School, there's still a big blow down area that's still visible.
Is that so?
Yes, almost going out of sight now, but it's very visible in the 70s.
Well, this gets us back up to, I know none of you were alive during the 1938 hurricane, but all of us were getting it was the beginning of our time of life, and so now we're to the time when the beavers could start making a return. And a lot of things happened in this, like the last, in our lifetimes, the last half of the 20th century up to the present, that affected our forest climate. And I'm going to be talking about a number of different ones, and they all interacted. One of the things that happened was that conservation became, for many of us, a value, a community value. And it wasn't, and conservation isn't quite enough of a word, because if we, you know, when we think back to American history and people's attitudes toward nature. Nature was something to be exploited and used, and it could be an enemy. I remember seeing, you know, birds of prey hung by their feet on barbed wire fences driving through the West because they were in competition for our resources. And so there's been a huge attitude change from a lot of people, not everybody, but a large base of people, that creatures like the beaver are our fellow creatures, and they don't have any choice about sharing the planet with us, but we are, a lot of us are inclined to offer them some respect. Now, I know you're thinking white-tailed deer, but we'll get to that. So this beaver, look at where he is. He's in a tunnel that goes under Route 2. This is a few years back, the town of Concord, when they put the Jersey barriers right down the middle of Route 2 through Concord, the state agreed to put in 4 wildlife tunnels. And because I had been doing that photo trapping, it's called, the motion-triggered cameras, I was part of the team that tried to monitor the tunnels to see what would use them. Well, isn't that a manifestation of this change of values, where instead of just saying that the animals didn't count or they were on their own, actual resources were put to trying to give them a way to inhabit their own range. The beavers were reintroduced and have come back in our lives big time. As we all know, sometimes they're a problem, but I think most people seem to be tickled to have that kind of problem over having species gone. That I don't know. And the coyote. Now the coyotes were very clever about the camera in the woods. You can see him shying away from it. He reacted quickly, and there weren't all that many coyote pictures taken. This is a story. We were talking about it a little bit before the meeting tonight. Because did anybody else hear the coyote presentation the other night? You did, but okay. The coyotes in the West are a much smaller animal than we have, and so there is the idea that maybe wolf genes got into our eastern coyotes as they migrated east. For whatever reason, if you see a coyote in Yellowstone Park, it's a lot smaller than it is the coyotes that we see here. And they have become, of course, very common in our area as the forests have matured. And this is one that's in a smaller tunnel, skulking his way through. And they're hunted, but the population has increased over the years. Which is a pretty dramatic difference in this graph. Now we get to the white-tailed deer. Here's one eating some lawn vegetation and chomping away at it. So I was talking about our tolerance and sympathy for our fellow wildlife, for the wildlife around us. And it's hard to deny that wild-tailed deer are very beautiful, but my wife would really prefer it if I could strangle all of them. And some of you were complaining about the tulip crop. They hammer ours if they come at the right time. But so we've got white-tailed deer are back. Here they are coming through the wildlife tunnel, seemingly ducking down, not to bump their heads, I guess. And there were surprises, always surprises in this camera trapping, motion triggered camera thing, like they're swimming through, really? And then, oh, you know, is this any of you? Because when I did a presentation for Jackie, and a man had come in and looked at the camera in the woods, and he was at the library that night, and he said, there I am. It was like, oh. So I always think I'm going to meet this guy, but not tonight. Okay. And another surprise was that fissures were all over the place, that you can't set up a motion-triggered camera in eastern Massachusetts and not get a fissure. This is my best fissure picture from that, but here's my favorite sequence. Now, this is a place where I had more than one camera. And so the fissure crosses in front of the camera and then turns around, because this is an old camera. It was a real film camera. Now it's all digital. But at that time, there was digital photography, but the battery life wasn't, you couldn't use them for this purpose because of the technology's gotten better. So this was a film camera. He heard it, he turned around, came over, and then he wants to smell it. So he's interested. And then, go figure. You know, my friend saw this. You know, the camera in the woods thing. I had a website for it, and the descendant of that website is the Sudbury Valley Trustees Nature Sightings page on their website, which is I'm very proud to have been part of the founding of that. Anyway, my friend saw this picture and he said, "Ron, does this mean that the fisher has a picture of you on his website?" There's another surprise. People suspected we had bobcats around, but you don't see them very often. And this cat, when he turned around, he revealed, if it was a lynx, which we don't really have lynx, they're more northerly, but if it was, the tail would be black all the way underneath at the tip of the tail. So this is a bobcat, and the athleticism and the kind of charisma of the bobcats just always blew me away. Does still. Now we go back to scats. This, we don't see too many of these. This is bear scat. But the bears, you know, as you know, wander through once in a while, and the steady population is predicted to continue slowly to move east. So maybe we'll end up with bears one of these days living here, but certainly now they're up. This picture was taken in northern New England, where the bear population has persisted. It particularly does well because of lumbering, because, you know, that restarts forest succession, and those early successive stages of regrowth have much more productive of food for bears and other creatures than a mature spruce forest, which is doesn't have a big carrying capacity. So here's a kind of a composite graph of successional habitat, using that word to mean change over time from newly clear cut, you know, full of berries, to shrubland, and then young forest, and then mature forest that we are getting to now. And so the beaver were out, the beaver are back, we know that. The deer have come back. The ruffed grouse went down probably because of harvesting, and then shot up during the farm abandonment period, and then have dropped off as the forests have matured. But the mature forest has its benefits for creatures. So here who would have ever thought that we'd see wild turkeys like we do now? I mean, didn't we think wild turkey was something that was like a creature of the imagination when we were little, and now it's very very much with us. The barred owl is another creature that likes mature forests. They have to have mature trees to build their nests in. They're a cavity nester. This is the owl that, I won't do my true imitation for you, but it's who cooks for you all is the way it's put. And so when you're walking in the woods, it's you know, if you walked every day, probably a few times a year, you would hear a barred owl hooting, even in the daytime. And then there are the pileated woodpeckers.
Can we hear that?
I'm sorry?
Who cooks for you? Who cooks for you?
Oh, you want to hear what it sounds like?
Yeah.
Thank you. He's nodding. I like it. I did that in the holiday. You know, sometimes they'll answer that. I have talked to them. But I tried it in the woods over the holidays. We had Betsy's sister with us, and she said, what did she say there? Who would ever respond? She thought it was the most ridiculous sound her brother-in-law had ever made. There you go. My daughter, on the other hand, was impressed, so that was good. Pileated woodpeckers, this is my backyard. We love it when they come by. You see them, they're huge. They are a wonderful creature to have around, and who doesn't feel richer for having pileated woodpeckers around. Well, that Camera in the Woods project was started.
So I just saw one of these in my backyard today. And are they fairly solo? Because I've never seen two.
I'm trying to think. I have seen them in pairs. It probably depends. But I think most of the time I just see one also. I don't know whether a pair would commonly forage together or not. When I lived in East Texas, as I did for a couple of years, I saw them often in groups there, I think. But I don't have a good answer to your question. Good question. That Camera in the Woods project started hoping to get a picture of the otter, and finally, it took a long time, I just had bad luck, but finally I got what I regard as a lovely, lovely picture of a river otter. And along the way, I picked up many pictures of fox. This is gray fox, all in focus, notice, and a red fox in the snow. Now, these foxes don't get too much mention in this talk. Why not? Because you couldn't defeat them. They were here all along. In the index to Thoreau's journals, there are many, many mentions of foxes. And one of them was, he liked to talk to the farmers. You know, he said, the farmer told him that he thought foxes did better in open land than they did deep in the woods. And he thought what they liked to do was lie up there on the hillside and watch the people. And that's how they got to be so cunning. So they're still here. And I've got some more fox pictures, though, because a couple years ago this is a deer kill. Betsy noticed out on the ice on a pond near us something red, and it was that deer. So I went down with my camera, and I took this picture of all the coyote tracks. And apparently the coyote had run the deer out onto the ice and been able to take it down. And so by this time I had myself a digital camera, and luckily it was right at the edge of the forest, so I was able to put the digital camera right there and was very excited to be able to watch night after night the creatures come to scavenge the carcass. So here's the coyote, and here is a red fox. And most of the pictures were fox. It was foxes either by themselves or in groups. Boy, were those nervous foxes. And I'm sure it was because, as we were saying, that they're scared of coyotes. And so the foxes kept looking over their shoulders. Here's two foxes that were there, but then a third came along. And so here's a zoom in on this picture. The ears back, three's a crowd. Only two, this carcass is just for the two of us. Disappear, please. And here again, looking for the coyote. I got many, many pictures of these animals. I happened to have one of the coyote and one of the fox in the same place, and I used Photoshop to superimpose them to give us, so you can see why the fox, why a coyote could prey on a fox. Well, I mentioned conservation as something that's come along in our lifetimes as a response to, very explicitly as a response to, the people who were leadership of the generation before mine came back from World War II, and they realized that suburbanization was coming this way, and they tried to do something about it. And their efforts have saved us gems like this. Here's the the percentage of developed land, and so conservation has not, of course, been trying. A guy said, Ron, everybody wants to live in the last house ever built. But a lot of houses have been built, but also we've been able, working together as communities, to save some land. And I know you have in this community. This is the headquarters of the Sudbury Valley Trustees, which I was executive director there for 10 years. I volunteered for them for a long time, still do. And it was they who had me write that book about the Concord, Sudbury, and Assabet River. So I've had a long relationship to that organization that continues, although I don't work there anymore. I asked the current executive director, my successor, I told her I'd be talking to you, and so she said that the story here is that SVT has helped the town of Bedford protect 64 acres. And we hold a conservation restriction on 5 parcels, 2 of which have public access. And SVT and the town continue a cooperative effort to protect natural areas. Once again, SVT will serve as a backup by holding a conservation restriction on the 2 adjacent parcels. So because 2 of the conservation areas have public access, SVT has prepared this material for the 2 of them. And do you know what a conservation restriction is? If you do, raise your hand. Okay, I'm sorry, since you're going to have to listen anyway.
I don't mind.
Okay, good. So a conservation restriction has become a very important tool. If I'm a landowner and I want to keep land in my family, I'm going to pay taxes on it for its highest and best use. So if it's a building lot, I'm going to pay taxes on it for its value as a building lot. That makes me want to sell it, so I don't have to pay the taxes on it. If, however, I could get rid of that value, then I could keep the land and not and pay taxes on it as conservation land. So if I sell the development rights, which is the way we think of it, if I sell or donate the development rights to someone, then that can be conservation land. But somebody has to receive that conservation restriction and enforce it. And that's where the land trusts come in. Different towns use different mechanisms to make this happen. Our state is very sophisticated about conservation restrictions. They have to be approved by the state. They can't just be something that some lawyers cook up and put in a deed writer. So conservation restrictions have given families ways to continue to manage their property and be able to afford to hold on to it and conserve it as their one tool. So a Sudbury Valley Trustees has a mixture of holdings. It has holdings that it holds in fee that are its own reservations that it just flat out owns. And then other times land is privately owned, but it's under conservation restriction. Well, that's the other one. So when I was executive director at Sudbury Valley Trustees, we commissioned an artist named Gordon Morrison to do this illustration of our service area, which is the land drained by the Concord, Sudbury, and Assabet rivers. And it is in the shape of a swamp white oak leaf, just the way nature made it. And so he did this illustration, and I show it to you. I sure appreciate your attendance tonight and your attention, and I would be happy to do my best to respond to any questions that you might have. Yes, yes.
You didn't mention the pheasants. I haven't seen a pheasant for a long time.
A pheasant is a Chinese bird, and it was stocked here very commonly during farming days, I love that honk honk sound the Uga sound that they made. But I think the state has, for one reason or another, stopped stocking them, and then they used to be able to sustain their own population, but they're an open land creature. So I could well have mentioned them as a non-native species that we used to see, but that as the forests have grown up, we've stopped seeing very much of.
Yeah,
here.
Yes, how do you feel about the ticks that the white-tailed deer are distributing all over the...
Well, there are numerous vectors to the... Lyme disease can be such a scourge, and I know people have suffered from it very much, and I feel awful about it, is how I feel about it. I wonder if... We've been kind of doing an informal poll. We think that the people who seem to have the most trouble with ticks are the people who also have dogs, and that the dogs pick up ticks. You know, I during this season of year starting now, and look, as a person who loves the outdoors, keep a close eye out, and of course I find ticks sometimes, and it's very bad. But tell me a little more about what you mean. I mean, we can't...
I mean, when we moved to Bedford,
yeah,
there weren't any ticks. There weren't any, not the wolverine, but the little fisher cats.
Mm-hmm.
There weren't any coyotes. And people have actually claimed they've seen mountain lion twice here in Bedford.
Mm.
My neighbors, two different neighbors. And I thought I for sure saw the carcass of one on 495. So there are all these other creatures that are now... were exterminated to preserve humans as well as livestock, and now we're harboring them and protecting them. So we're overpopulating them.
I think most environmentally sensitive people would if you're saying that when you say overpopulated, that white-tailed deer are overpopulated in our area, I think most the ecologists would agree with you, because aside from their role in spreading Lyme disease, which is bad enough, but they also over browse the forest and make it hard for the natural processes of forest to go on. So people, Sudbury Valley Trustees has started allowing hunting on some of its lands. It's just difficult where there's such where the deer are so adaptable and there are it's hard to hunt, right? You know, and you can't hunt close to houses, so it's going to be a problem, I think. Yeah. I certainly don't have a simple answer to it.
How many mountain lions would you consider overpopulation in Bedford?
In Bedford, they deer. One of my friends suggested that what we should do is start a population of Siberian tigers. Yes, ma'am.
This spring, between the snow and the thaw, and then the snow again in the thaw part, I've lived in Burlington since 1970, and in the fall I saw three deer, and in this thaw time I saw seven deer, and they came very close to the house. They ate the greenery. I had some rhododendrons and stuff. And after they ate, they took a siesta, and they were wiggling their ears and their tails, and they fell asleep. Now, I want to know, is it safer for me to wait until the fall to go into my own backyard, or can I stay out altogether? It's wooded. It's like the houses have like a small backyard, but the rest of the property is still wooded from my side and the other side. So there's a strip of wooded land between the houses behind them.
My hearing is imperfect, and I'm not sure I understood the nub of your question. Were you saying that you were afraid to go near the deer?
I'm not. The deer, I don't care. I'm afraid that where they sat and whatever.
Oh, because of the ticks.
They were, you know, their ears, I didn't know their ears were that long. And their tails were, I was surprised how long their tails were. But their tails were going and the ears were going, and then they were lying down and one of them was sleeping sideways. So I figure I have a lot of deer ticks very close to my property, and I am what, because I've seen schematics or whatever, mm-hmm, like in the spring, you can barely see the lines.
Mm-hmm.
But they get sort of bigger. But do they keep having crops all the way through the season, or is it that in the spring there's like a no-see-em, and then towards the end, at least you have a chance to get them off your body.
Well, one thing I am not is an expert on deer ticks and Lyme disease any more than most of you. So I can speak anecdotally that some years it's just in the spring, but it can be very early in the spring and have a lot of ticks, and then none the whole rest of the year that I find or that I experience. But other years I'm apt to find a tick most any time here and there. But that's just my anecdote. I know from hearing experts talk about, you know, preventing Lyme disease that they, at least according to my medical people, that they have to be embedded in your flesh for a pretty long time. So if you're vigilant about it, that you're apt to be able to take them out before that they infect you. But of course, they can go unnoticed. People get Lyme disease; they don't know how they got. I realize all that, so it's not something that I can really lecture on.
It's very likely that you will not see them.
But they have to be in the host to survive. So maybe they drop them all down, but they're only going to last a week or so without being on a body, and they're going to die.
So if
your deer don't come back, then you're
safe. Okay, we do have limited time, so are there any other questions?
Yes, sir.
I'm curious about the damming of the Concord River over the years, what you've ascertained about that and how that's affected the way it's developed and evolved. Particularly, I think the dam up in Billerica used to be a lot more wetlands and floodplains. Your thoughts on that?
Well, it's a fascinating subject, and it's Thoreau was involved in that too. Did you know that he was involved in the lawsuit? They started suing the owners of the North Billerica Dam a long time ago, because they claimed that they were ruining the hay fields in Sudbury and Wayland, and it was in the courts forever. And I think they finally decided that the Fordway Bar, which is just upstream of the dam, was the determined the level of the river more than the current level of the dam. But it's been a huge issue. Whether the vegetation, the character, the ecological characteristic of especially the Sudbury or the Sudbury and the Concord rivers is the broad meadows that flood out on the side, and that's remnant from the glacial lakes left over from the glacial lake. Whether the damming has changed the vegetation in some way that we can wring our hands about, it might have, but I don't know. But I know that a lot of the vegetation that's there, like button bush, is native vegetation, and it's not, you know, with all the problems we have with invasive species, it's not as though these vast acreages have become Phragmites covered. And the whole quarrel about the dams, you know, as soon as the settlers got here, they started damming everything they could dam to saw logs and grind grain. And so these mill ponds are all over the place, and they were a big factor in our history. And add to the color walking through the woods of trying to figure out, you know, was there a water wheel here, and where did the tail race go? So the fun of interpreting the sites from hundreds of years ago was a great, great thing about living in. I'm an adopted Massachusetts guy, and that's one of the things I love about it. Did you have a question?
I'm a river steward. I've worked with the Sudbury Valley Trustees, plus the Sewasco Wild and Scenic Rivers. Uh-huh. I'd just like to point out to the audience that as of a year and a half ago, there were only 11 wild and scenic rivers in the whole United States. And our combination of the Assabet, Sudbury, and Concord River is one of the 11. And the National River is coming on, a couple of others, but right now, we got a valuable resource out there. Appreciate it.
I would have thought for the whole country that it might have been a higher number than that.
I'm not
really.
A year and a half ago, there's others chewing out.
But it's a good point, and I've also been part of that activity. And the Park Service, which runs that program, has their specific criteria that make the river eligible for wild and scenic status. Of course, wildness in the way we usually think of it is not a characteristic of our river, but As the name of this program, it has the literature about these rivers, the natural history, the recreational value, and the free-flowing, undammed part. Because from North Billerica all the way up to the Saxonville Dam in Framingham is free-flowing. The Sudbury and Concord system is free-flowing. You don't have a single canoe portage that whole way. And that's the segment that is Wallensee.
I'd like to end. The politics of it is why there are only 11. You have to get every community along the way. You have to have a congressperson who's really in favor of it. And getting every selectman in every town wasn't easy in Bedford.
I never thought that all 8 towns would vote it in, and they did. Oh. Is there a question? Yeah, Melinda.
Yeah, I understand that you're leading a canoe trip on the river coming up this spring.
Yes, it's 400. It's Thoreau's 200th birthday. Not 200th birthday, and so Sudbury Valley Trustees invited me to do another of the literary canoe outings that I used to do, where we paddle off and have readings from some of the literature that makes this wild and scenic, from Thoreau and others. So that's on the Sudbury Valley Trustees website. That's in June. Yes, sir?
How large an area do otters cover?
They cover a lot, and I can't quantify it for you, but I know that they're constantly moving and wandering.
We've got them in our brook, and they come and go.
Yeah.
We see them in the water, but never on land.
Coming and going
is... I've seen tracks in the snow on the land.
Have you ever seen them playing?
We have not.
I have not either, and you know, I really envy people who've had that opportunity to see them sliding. But every time I see, I have seen them catching fish and coming up and eating the fish, and it's just exciting to see them. Well, thanks again for coming. Now, a slide presentation that begins with a random elephant picture, I thought should end with a random monkey. Thank you so much for coming tonight.
And thank you all for coming. Don't